Beneath the surface of modern Canada lies a genetic story thousands of years in the making. So in this video, we're going to look at the DNA story of Canada, see how the genetic makeup of the country has changed over time, and we'll also look at the most common haplogroups there today. Now, Canada gets its name from the Iroquoian word Can-Uta, meaning village or settlement. Over time, Canada came to denote the French colony along the St. Lawrence River, and eventually the vast country we know today. In 1867, Canada became a self-governing dominion within the British Empire through the confederation of several British North American colonies. While it gained full legislative independence in the 20th century, Canada remains a constitutional monarchy. King Charles III serves as Canada's official head of state, represented domestically by the Governor-General, although most of their powers are largely ceremonial. But what about the genetic history of Canada? And let me know in the comments below if you are Canadian and what your ancestry is. Now, the first humans arrived in Canada via Beringia, the ancient land bridge from Siberia and Alaska, roughly 15,000 to 20,000 years ago. Genetic evidence indicates this initial founding group was small, but expanded rapidly after entering the New World. These paleo-indigenous peoples carry distinctive haplogroups that still define much of the indigenous genetic heritage today. On the male side, the dominant paternal lineage among these people was the Y-DNA haplogroup Q, specifically QM242 and its sub-branch QM3. Haplogroup Q likely arose in Siberia and is found at high frequency in indigenous populations across the Americas, reflecting their common origin. Another paternal lineage present amongst early groups was CM217. This was initially quite rare, but a specific branch, CP39, would become significant in some northern communities during later migrations that we will discuss shortly. On the maternal side, five major mitochondrial DNA haplogroups, A, B, C, D, and X, were carried by these first Americans. Nearly all indigenous peoples from North to South America today belong to one of these five founding maternal lineages. In general, these early settlers shared genetic ancestry with East Asian and Siberian populations, particularly those from regions near Lake Baikal. This genetic profile persisted for millennia, diversifying into the many First Nations and other indigenous peoples of Canada. After the initial peopling, however, additional migrational waves from Asia contributed new genetic threads to northern North America. The ancestors of Na-Dene and Inuit peoples represent later arrivals who admixed with or supplanted earlier groups in certain regions. A 2012 study published in Nature, for instance, found that the initial peopling of the Americas happened in at least three main waves, all from Asia. Ancestors of the Na-Dene Lineage family introduced higher levels of the Y-chromosomal haplogroup, CP39 for example. About 800 to 1,000 years ago, the Thule people, who are ancestors of modern Inuit peoples, expanded eastward from Alaska across the Arctic to Greenland, largely replacing an earlier Arctic culture known as the Dorset people in Canada's far north. From a genetic perspective, Inuit carry typical Native American haplogroups, but often with different sublineages. For instance, Arctic-specific mitochondrial DNA subhaplogroups such as A2A, A2B, D4B1A and D2 occur at high frequencies in Inuit communities, distinguishing them from Southern First Nations. So this is what the early genetic history looked like, but what about later episodes? Well, the first Europeans to reach Canadian shores were the Vikings. Around 1000 AD, Norse expeditions led by Leif Erikson established a small encampment at Lancer Meadows in Newfoundland. Stories of these voyages and interactions with native peoples are found in the Vinland sagas, a number of tales, Icelandic tales, that were written down in the 13th century. From a genetic perspective though, the Vikings obviously had no real impact on the DNA of Canada, but later Europeans did. The first European known to have landed in Canada after the Viking Age was John Cabot. He was an Italian navigator working for England who arrived in 1497. It wasn't until the French arrived though that things really changed. France was the first European power to colonise large parts of Canada, beginning with Jacques Cartier's voyages in the 1530s, and the establishment of New France shortly after. The French brought Western European Y-DNA haplogroups into the land we call Canada today. The most common was R1b, the dominant male line lineage in France and Western Europe in general. The main branches of this haplogroup that were brought in were R1B U106, which is very much associated with Germanic ancestry, both today and historically, and R1B P312 and its subclades. These subclades included R1B U152, which is common in eastern France, Switzerland and northern Italy, and is associated with the Latin Celts down through history. Another subclad was R1B DF27, common in southwestern France and Iberia, and also R1B L21, which is more common in Brittany and amongst the Atlantic Celts in general. Other Y-DNA haplogroups brought in by the French settlers included I1 and I2, and smaller amounts of the likes of E1B1B, G and J2. French women also brought European mitochondrial haplogroups into Canada. The most frequent was haplogroup H, which is the single most common mitochondrial lineage in Europe. About 40 to 50% of Europeans carry H. They also introduced other mitochondrial haplogroups that are found in Europe, such as U5. Later Europeans compounded this genetic influence though. Now, British influence in Canada began in the early 1600s, but it really became dominant in the mid-1700s. An early episode was in 1621, when Nova Scotia or New Scotland was granted to Scottish settlers by King James VI, also known as King James I, who had become the King of Scotland, England and Ireland in 1603 through the Union of the Crowns. The colony didn't take hold, however, and by 1632, the territory was ceded back to the French. It was in the 18th century that British influence really ramped up. A notable event was when the French and Indian War ended in 1763, and France ceded almost all its North American territories to Britain in the Treaty of Paris of 1763. This British period again brought more European genetics into Canada, which had a similar genetic profile to the French. After the American Revolution, about 30 to 40,000 loyalists, i.e. American colonists loyal to Britain, moved to British Canada. These loyalists added not only British-derived genes though, but also some German, Dutch and other Northern European lineages. This introduced higher levels of Y-DNA haplogroups such as R1B U106 into Canada, very much associated with Germanic ancestry, as well as I1, which is common in Northern Europe and Scandinavia still today. This general European period in Canada also brought diseases that indigenous peoples had no immunity to. This devastated the population size of many indigenous groups. Admixture between Europeans and indigenous peoples also created some interesting and unique genetic profiles. The Métis people are a prime example of this. They often carry a combination of indigenous mitochondrial haplogroups and European Y-DNA haplogroups, reflecting their mixed indigenous and European ancestry. Now, there have obviously been various other later migrations into Canada. Events such as the Highland Clearances in Scotland and the Great Hunger in Ireland caused many people to leave for Canada. This increased the rate of haplogroups such as R1B L21, which is more common in Scotland and Ireland. Many other groups further enriched Canada's gene pool though. Ukrainians and other Eastern Europeans began settling in Canada from around the 1890s onwards, for example. They brought with them Slavic genetic markers such as R1A on the Y-DNA side, for instance. Various other peoples migrated as well, including East Asian and South Asian populations, people of African and Caribbean descent, amongst many others. But how have all these people down through history contributed to the genetic makeup of Canada today, and what haplogroups are most common in the country today? Well, look at this map. It shows the largest self-reported ethnic or cultural origins in Canada. It is based on the 2021 census and gives a really interesting overview of the country. Canadian, English, Irish, Scottish and French were the top five self-reported ethnic origins, which combine both single and multiple responses. You can see the Inuit population to the Northern Arctic region in dark pink, and the distribution of the various other peoples of Canada across the country. Now, as far as haplogroups, the most common Y-DNA marker in the country is R1B, at around 45% of the population. This haplogroup is mainly associated with British, Irish and French ancestry, tracing back to the early colonial migrations. It is higher in certain parts of Canada though. A 2025 study published in Nature, for instance, analysed over 1,000 people from Newfoundland and Labrador, the easternmost province of Canada. They found R1B in 71.4% of men, which primarily resemble those observed in English and Irish ancestral source populations. They also found geographical and religious clustering associated with the settlement of the ancestral source populations. For example, the Y-DNA haplogroup R1B-M222, which is downstream from the broader haplogroup RL21, associated with Atlantic Celts in general, is seen in people of Irish descent, and is found clustered in the Irish-settled southeast region of Newfoundland and Labrador. This radial diagram shows the overall results of this study. R1B is the most common, as you can see, but you can also see the frequencies of other haplogroups, such as R1A, Q, and branches of I. And this leads us nicely on to the second most common Y-DNA haplogroup in Canada overall, which is I, branches of I, mainly the I1 branch. This largely points to Northern European roots, especially Scandinavia and Northern Germany. R1A is the third most common Y-DNA haplogroup, with around 5-10% of Canadian males carrying this genetic marker. This haplogroup is common in Eastern Europeans and also in some populations of South Asia. The fourth most common is haplogroup O, found in around 3-5% of Canadian Y-DNA lineages. This haplogroup is specific to East Asia, so its presence in Canada stems from East Asian migration from, say, people with Chinese ancestry or Korean ancestry. Haplogroup Q is the fifth most common in the country, at approximately 2-4%. The main branch is QM3. This general lineage arrived with the indigenous peoples of the Americas and remains the most widespread indigenous paternal haplogroup in Canada. Other Y-DNA haplogroups found in Canada include E1B1B, Jai, and G2A. What about the maternal side though? Well, the most common mitochondrial haplogroup in the country is H, similar to Europe. This is a clear legacy of the European influence, especially the French and the British. Haplogroup Jai is another quite common maternal haplogroup in Canada, a prominent European Near Eastern maternal clad. Other European mitochondrial haplogroups found in the country in reasonable numbers are T, U, and K. The most common mitochondrial haplogroup amongst Indigenous Canadians is A2, with frequencies reaching over 90% in some Inuit communities. Other indigenous mitochondrial haplogroups include B2, C1, D1, and X2A. Now, this last mitochondrial haplogroup is especially interesting, as X2A is unique to North American indigenous populations. Unlike A, B, C, and D, this haplogroup is not found in East Asia, making it all the more intriguing. Other branches of X are found in the likes of Europe and Asia in general, but X2A, this X2A branch, is unique to North America. One theory is that it formed in ancient Beringia, the region between Siberia and Alaska that was once thought to be twice the size of Texas, and the ancestors of indigenous populations. So as we have seen, Canada reflects a genetic melting pot of various different ancestries, from indigenous to European to global ancestries. But what does your eye colour say about your ancestry? Well, to find out, please click here. Thanks for watching, please subscribe and hit the bell, and let me know your thoughts in the comments below, and I'll see you next time.